right? Part of the value of this is getting that kind of depth of explanation about a counterplan. But if you don't know what the other kinds of negative arguments are, you want to go to that rookie introduction, because it'll give you the foundation for how to be negative in general, not just from this one kind of specific argument, which I'll be honest, is not an argument that you will run all the time. Counterplans are kind of special, theoretical arguments that are really helpful and strategic, but they are not usually the bulk or the foundation of negative argumentation, especially for novice students. All right. So I'm gonna, a lot of information about counterplans to cover, and I'm going to cover most of it, and then I'm going to leave a little bit of time at the end so that we can ask some questions either about the counterplan lecture I'm about to give you, or so that you can ask questions about the topicality lecture that I gave you earlier. And there are ways that these two lectures or these two different topics actually really work together. That should become relatively self-evident as we get into this particular topic. Okay. So again, my name is Alexis. If you weren't here earlier, I coach at City College of San Francisco. And I really like counterplans. I think that they are a really wonderful strategic tool for you to, use to test the affirmative and to test the resolution. Most people think that when they're debating the other team. That's kind of true because they're the representatives of the affirmative side of the debate. But really what you're debating is the resolution. And it is your job on the negative to test the resolution. And one of the ways that we can test it is by offering a counter proposal or a different plan of action that we might be able to take instead of whatever the affirmative has offered, in order to solve the same harms or accomplish some of the same goals, right? So a lot of this is in reference to the resolution. So what is a counterplan, right? A counterplan, like I just said, is an alternative way of solving a problem. It's a negative strategy that you can utilize. The primary operating word here I wanna highlight is different. It's a different solution. And we're going to talk about specific ways that it needs to be different in order for it to be competitive. Because one of the theoretical components of the counterplan that the affirmative gets to test is whether or not it's competitive, meaning could we do them at the same time, or are they mutually exclusive? So you don't just want it to be a little different. You actually want it to be a lot different if you can. That more difference there is between your counterplan and the plan, often the easier it is for you to accomplish your goal of winning the debate and using that counterplan as your primary argument that, that the judge will vote for. I also think about it as a way of attacking the harms or some of the advantages, if you like that language, about the plan. Sometimes you don't want to disagree with the affirmative. They might say something like sexism exists and that's bad. I would not recommend impact turning this argument, right? You don't have to say sexism is good, right? Instead, you might offer an alternative way of solving for sexism that might actually have more long-lasting value, might make a deeper impact in whatever field you're talking about, right? So, counterplans are really great alternatives when you're struggling with an offensive argument that you can make in response to whatever the affirmative is. And as I've said, it's a negative strategy. You don't just run a counterplan. You often run it in conjunction with other things, usually a disadvantage or two, right? And so part of having a strong negative strategy is recognizing that when you offer a counterplan, you need to have net benefits to it, which I'm going to talk about, or you need to have additional offense in the debate. The other thing I might highlight or remind you about at this moment is that the negative gets this thing called negation theory. negation theory. Has anybody heard this term before? Negation theory? Maybe? Okay. So negation theory is the idea that the negative gets to try out lots of different arguments on the negative side of the debate, and the affirmative is stuck with, if you were in the top Cali lecture this morning, whatever's in the frame. And the negative gets everything outside of the frame. And not only do they get everything outside the frame, they don't even really always have to be totally consistent. Meaning, you can take different parts from outside the frame in order to put together a negative strategy, because you're just testing the affirmative from all of those different places, right? Likewise, at the end of the debate, you don't have to go for all of your arguments. In fact, you shouldn't, right? You should distill down to what the core or key arguments are in the debate. And so you might offer a counterplan at the beginning of the debate, and you may or may not go for it at the end of the debate. But if you're going to go for the counterplan, you also have to go for the disadvantage or whatever other arguments you have packed up into your counterplan strategy. So there's a couple things that a counterplan has to do, three to be particular. Number one, a good counterplan will prove that it is more desirable than the affirmative plan of action. Ideally, it at a minimum has to solve the F. At a minimum, it has to solve the affirmative. Whatever advantages have been provided or whatever harms have been provided, the counterplan has to solve it. But ideally, it will actually solve it better than the affirmative, whether it's a bit sooner time frame, like the solvency would happen sooner, or maybe it is a more complete solvency or solution that will actually wrap up the entire issue rather than part of the issue. It also should be net beneficial, meaning there are more net benefits to the counterplan than there are to the plan. Net benefits, right, you think about this often, for those of you that are just learning about debate, right, we think about it often as a criteria, right, or the mechanism with which the judge should evaluate the debate, right? Which one has more net benefits, the plan or the negative, right? Just a really, just a different way of talking about advantages and disadvantages, right? When you run a counterplan, you don't just need to win that it solves the app and that it might be better than the app. You need to win that there are advantages to your counterplan. Advantages to your counterplan are disadvantages to the plan. I'm going to say that again because this is really important and it sounds screwy, but it is perhaps one of the most eye-opening moments you can have around counterplans and disadvantages. Advantages to the counterplan are disadvantages to the affirmative. Advantages to the counterplan are disadvantages to the plan. Yeah? I see some of you are like, yeah, groovy. Right? It is groovy because it means that those are independent pieces of offense or disadvantages that you can leverage against the affirmative across the debate and use them as reasons to vote for the counterplan as an alternative solution or a different way of dealing with the act. Which part?
Advantages to the counterplan is the disadvantage
to the plan. Yeah. Advantages to the counterplan are disadvantages to the plan. Right? And I'm gonna add one more part there. Just like advantages to the plan are disadvantages to the counterplan. Advantages to the plan are disadvantages to the counterplan if the counterplan doesn't solve it. Sometimes people offer counterplans that solve half of your app. They solve like one of the two advantages. If the counterplan doesn't solve both advantages in your affirmative, you should say things like, yeah, they might have solved the relations advantage, but they have not solved the economy advantage, which means the economy advantage is a disadvantage or an offensive reason to reject the counterplan. The second thing that a counterplan has to be is different from the plan. I said this a little bit already. It doesn't just have to be different, it has to be what we call mutually exclusive, which means that we couldn't do both at the same time. This is actually perhaps one of the most real-world parts about counterplan debate, right? If, let's say, in Congress, a bill was proposed, and somebody proposed a counter bill that just added on to that original bill, the original bill writers would just add it in. They would be like, oh, that's, if that's a legitimately good idea that helps or enhance or support the original plan, they would just add it on. Be like, thank you. We call that a plan plus counterplan. Plan plus counterplan. You don't want to do that. Plan plus counterplans are bad because the affirmative then still has won that their plan is a good idea. And you've just kind of given them some additional information or some additional arguments or maybe even some additional mechanisms, actors or processes to help enhance their plan. You want it to be different. You don't want it to be not done at the same time. So if the affirmative plan, for example, were something like implement a no first use nuclear policy, which is the example I used in Topicality this morning. If the affirmative plan is to implement a no first use policy, so we won't trigger the nukes first, we would only use them in response to somebody else's use of nuclear weapons, right? That's the plan. A mutually exclusive counterplan would be something like, let us increase the likelihood of using nuclear weapons. Let us elevate and not just have a first use policy, but let us declare that we will use them in a specific instance, right? Now, there's problems with that because that probably doesn't solve the harms of the affirmative, and I don't want to go too far down that path right now. But I think it's helpful in thinking about the difference between what the plan and the counterplan should do. Often counterplans move in a different direction, or they use a different agent, right? We're going to talk about different types of counterplans. You have to remember that it needs to be mutually exclusive. You should not be able to do them at the same time. The affirmative will always say that we can do them at the same time, and you're going to have to win that you can't. The third thing that your counterplan should do should prove that not only can't they work together, but it would be undesirable for them to work together, or there might be a negative consequence, right? Or we might call it a disadvantage for the two of them to work together, right? So, for example, often people will make the argument, right, that if you did the plan and the counterplan, there still would be a link to whatever disadvantage you're running with the counterplan, right? Whether it's an elections disadvantage or an economy disadvantage, right? Anything along those lines. So you want to win that they're mutually exclusive, and you want to win that it would be undesirable or there would be negative consequences if we did them together. Part of what these two things are trying to do is set up for the judge that you either vote for the plan or the counterplan. Yeah, can you give an example of that?
Of what? Of how it would be undesirable to do the two together?
Sure. So the example that I just gave, I think, is pretty helpful. So I'll explain it again, and I'll tell me if you want a different one. So if the plan is to implement a no first use policy, and the negative runs an elections or politics disadvantage, and in the politics disadvantage, the link is about expending all of the political capital that Congress has to pass this no first use policy. So counterplan, let's do something else, right, to change our nuclear policy. And the affirmative gets up and they're like, no, let's do the permutation, right? If you've heard this before, permutation, let's do both, right? Let us move to a no first use policy and do this other thing that you're talking about. The negative could then get up and be like, not only is it mutually exclusive, but you still link to the elections disad. It's still going to cost all of that political capital to pass that no first use policy. So even if you're right and we could do the plan and the counterplan at the same time and it would solve the affirmative, you still have this big nasty politics disadvantage that you haven't really taken care of or done anything about. Does that make more sense?
Yes.
Yeah, so whenever you're negative, you always want to make sure that the link story on your disadvantage, your criticism, or your case turns are maintained through the counterplan discussion, right? Because you need to win that there's a net benefit to the counterplan or disadvantage to the affirmative in order to win the counterplan debate. That makes more sense?
Cool.
So let's look at the different parts of the counterplan. So these are the things that you would need to opposition, constructive, right? There are three components. Just like the affirmative has a plan text, you have to have a counterplan text. And it kind of operates the same in the debate. So if the other team asks you to write it down or to share it or to repeat it, it should be exactly the same every time, right? If the affirmative just had a different plan, even just slightly modified in each speech, you would be really frustrated on the negative, right? And this is where the affirmative, right, gets to have you offer a stable locus for the debate and the counterplan, which is the counterplan text. Your counterplan text should include who is taking the action, so the agent. It should include the action that is being taken, and it should include the object of that action. So just like a plan has to describe their agent, who does the plan, the action, limiting, right, and the object of that, nuclear weapons, right, your counterplan has to do all the same things. And your counterplan also has to do all the same things. And just like an affirmative plan, you also have to offer solvency arguments. In LD and policy debate, these come in the form of pieces of evidence. In Carly debate, these come in the form of warrants or offering specific evidence and examples where this counterplan has either solved in the past or the people who claim it will solve in the future, right? So this answers the how question of how the counterplan, one, solves the affirmative, and two, avoids the disadvantage. You have to have both parts. How does the counterplan solve the affirmative? And how does the counterplan solve or avoid the disadvantage that you're using as a net benefit? Which is the third thing. Right, you gotta have net benefits. Net benefits, right, are like advantages to the counterplan. These are independent effects or reasons why the judge should prefer the counterplan over the affirmative plan. The most common way, and I've used it as an example a bunch already, is a disadvantage or two. You might even have two disadvantages, right, that are net benefits to the counterplan, but are not net benefits to the plan. Right, so they are distinct, bless you, right? They are distinctly disadvantages to the plan by themselves, and that's what's also kind of cool about this strategy. If you have two disadvantages in a counterplan in the debate, you have a route to success in three different places. Each one of those disadvantages operates as individual pieces of offense or reasons not to go for the plan, and then the counterplan operates as an alternative vote, right? The judge can vote for the counterplan instead of the plan. So this is very much about sort of competing solutions. So now we're going to talk about the different kinds of counterplans, right? Different kinds of counterplans. The first kind of counterplan we'll talk about is an agent counterplan. Agent counterplans are when everything about the plan and the counterplan is the same, except who does it. Right, so you are changing the agent of the counterplan. An example of that, right, is let's say the U.S. federal government is the agent in the resolution and in the affirmative plan, right? The counterplan might have the individual states, right, the 50 individual states in the United States, pass it on a state level rather than on a federal level. Right? This is a very common counterplan. We call it the state's counterplan. The state's counterplan is a good example of an agent counterplan, but there are others, right? You might have a different agent outside of the government enact the plan, right? Because there's something very different about the federal government implementing a plan, right? Compared to, say, someone in the private sector, whether it's an individual company, or even some other independent regulation authority or body. Okay. So it's all about changing who does the plan. They'll still take the same action, they'll still have the same object of action, it's just a different person or body or group of people, right, who are implementing the plan. Some net benefits that are often associated with agent counterplans. One of them is a time frame argument, or that it might be more efficient to have a different actor do it. So, for example, the government can be really slow sometimes, right? Like with a heavy, heavy, thick bureaucracy, right? And so having the federal government putting law in place can sometimes take a long time, and that means it would take a long time to solve for the impacts and the advantages. If you have a counterplan where someone or an organization in the private sector completes the plan, they might be able to do it much faster. Meaning that we can solve the harms of the affirmative faster, and maybe even in a more acute or specific way. Another common example that's used, right, is what I've cut up here as aid trade-off. You can think about it as like an economics argument, right? But if the plan uses the federal government, which means they're using government funds or taxpayer funds, it might be possible to do it using private sector money, right? So there'd be a benefit of saving money, right, in the government, which would have its own positive effects or impacts. Yeah?
So what are agents again?
What's an agent? When I'm referring to agents in terms of the resolution, who can answer that? Yeah?
Is it like you mentioned, the person that's going to tell, for example, you're talking about the US, the United States, or just specific states, like whoever that's doing the
Good. It's the who. Who is doing the plan, right? Obviously, you're advocating for it in the debate, but you are not going to be the implementers of the plan, right? It's usually a governmental agency or a non-governmental agency or group body. Yeah.
Is this permeable?
An agent counterplan?
Yeah.
Affirmatives will always perm your counterplan,
okay.
Right? And they should, right? When you're affirmative, you should always perm the counterplan, even if it's just as a test of competition, to see if it's different, right? And if the answer on a categorical scale is probably different depending on the counterplan. So for example, if the affirmative offers a plan where the federal government should do something, and then the negative offers a counterplan which happens in the private industry, are those mutually exclusive? What do you think?
No, you can do both.
Why? Why could you do both?
They're different agencies, so they operate independently.
Right, they operate independently. And sometimes there are certain issues where you want the government and private industry working together on an issue. And then the PERM becomes its own unique advocacy in the debate, right? Some issues, it's like a total trade-off, right? Like if the government is working on it, private sector won't touch it, or vice versa, right? So that's why I can't answer, say, all the time, right, agent counterplans are permeable or not permeable, right? It's always going to depend on who the agents are and what issue you're trying to solve. And I would even put that solvency issue question, would forefront that a little. What are we trying to do, and who is the best actor or agent, right, for completing that? That's a really good question, though.
Yeah, totally.
So there's also process counterplans. So it's not just who's doing it, it's how do we do it, right? So a process counterplan offers a counterplan that uses a different process than the affirmative. An example of that, let's say the affirmative says we should use Congress to pass a bill. Right, we should use Congress to pass a bill. A really popular or normal counterplan that I've heard a lot is the executive order, sometimes called the XO counterplan. Right? Executive orders, right, are when the president just implements it right away. The process, right, of getting a bill passed through Congress can be tiring and cumbersome and long. Right? And sometimes we need to immediately put things into action. Right? So the XO counterplan or the executive order counterplan, right, is a different process. It's a different way of accomplishing the same goal. A really common net benefit that goes along with this, we've talked about time frame already. That's one good example of a net benefit. Also the politics disadvantage. Right? If you have not heard about the politics disadvantage, you will. perhaps one of the core sets of argumentation and policy debate, regardless of the format that you're doing it in. And you will definitely hear it this semester because we are in an election year. Fundamentally, this is a disadvantage around trying to get a lot done and trying to pass certain kinds of policies in the run-up to an election can affect the way that the election goes down. And I'm not just talking about the presidential election. In fact, I think there will be a lot of what we call down-ballot politics disadvantages this year. Down-ballot just means other races and issues that are being voted on that are happening down later, farther on the ballot, not just that primary presidential ballot that you're thinking about. There's lots of senators and congresspeople that are up for re-election this year. There's some new elections. There's also a number of policies and state propositions that are up this year. So what we do right now in this time leading up to the election has an effect on those elections, right? Specifically those down ballot elections. So if you use Congress to try to do something right now, it could affect those congresspeople's ability to get reelected. So they will make different decisions right now than they would a year from now once the election is over. A process counterplan gets around some of that. Because if you don't use Congress and you just have the president put it into play, those congresspeople don't end up spending all that political capital where they make a different kind of decision based on the information that's available. Another counterplan, and it's what we call the time frame counterplan, is as you might intuit, that we just do it at a different date and time. Sometimes this will manifest itself, so we'll call it the delay counterplan, right? We should just delay putting the plan into action, right, until we get to some other future specified date. You have to identify the date, though. You don't just get to be like, counterplan, put it on pause, and somebody will do it, all right? Usually it was a specific time frame, like, you know, counterplan, wait 6 months until after the election is over, and then do the plan. Right, so anytime you play with a time frame of when the plan would be implemented. Common net benefits, we just talked about the elections disadvantage. Right? And so delaying it until after the election, right, would solve the link, right, or avoid the disadvantage, right, because you would not prompt the problems or the consequences of that disadvantage are, right, which is really all this is explaining. I would say that delay counterplans are pretty particular and specific to election years, unless there are other major bills that are up. So sometimes when there are other major bills or decisions that are getting made, sometimes we want to wait until after that's over. I think a good example of that, recently in the past year, the United States participated in the Paris Accords, right, which is a global climate change conference. If right before we went to that conference, we decided to pass a bill about our domestic climate policy, like we could do that. But there might be some disadvantages to that, including we would have this whole new policy and we would go to the Paris Accords to talk to everybody in the world about what our climate policy is and what we're doing to decrease greenhouse gas emissions, amongst other things. And we would get there and we would have to come back and change it again. So you might offer a delay counterplan. Let's wait until after we get back from the Paris Accords and make sure that the things that we want to implement lock up with what the world wants slash needs, right? And there are probably some advantages, like relationships with other countries, right? In addition to like collaborative policy making, right? Or other reasons we might want to just wait until after that event, right? So whenever you're going to delay it, there needs to be a specific thing or moment in time, right, that you're trying to avoid or get around. Another popular counterplan is the consultation counterplan. The consultation counterplan. This argument says that we will do the plan, but after we've conferred or consulted with an interested or important party. Right? So we're going to pass the plan, we'll do the same thing. We just want to go talk to some people about it first. So for example, if the U.S. were developing a new or negotiating a new relationship with Palestine, it might behoove us to have a conversation with Israel first, right? Israel is a major ally of the United States, in addition to being a major enemy of Palestine. And if we were to just go in and start having a conversation with Palestine or Palestinian leaders and not talk to Israel, there might be some negative consequences, right? So instead, the negative might offer an argument, right, a consultation counterclaim that we should consult Israel first. We should talk to them. A good example of a net benefit, right, are relations, right? Our relationship with Israel could be threatened if we choose not to consult with them first, and this is such an important issue. Another popular consultation counterplan that's used is Russian consultation, that we should consult with Russia about our relationship with people like Ukraine or Poland or NATO, right? Decisions or working with different people or other countries that would have an effect or shade the way that Russia sort of thought about our relationship with them. So we should talk to Russia first. It's basically like a, hey, we're going to go give Russia or Israel an FYI about what we're doing, and then we'll pass your plan. All right, the last kind of counterplan that I'm going to talk about is what we call a PIC, or a plan inclusive counterplan. A plan inclusive counterplan. This is a little bit more theoretical. In the way that counterplans work, but it basically makes the argument that we should only do parts or pieces of the affirmative. We should only do parts or pieces of the affirmative, and we should exclude certain sections of it, depending on whatever those sections are, whether it's an action, an agent, a language choice, right? But it's the idea that you're only going to do a piece or part of the plan. So, we often will refer to picking out of something, right? Because you are picking out of the part of the case that you don't want to advocate for, or quite frankly, that you have a link to another offensive argument that you will use in the debate, right? So we pick out of ideas, or we pick out, right, of different kind of parts of the affirmative. So one example is about process, right? So you might pick out of the part of the plan that would link you to a disadvantage. So let's say the affirmative uses Congress to pass a plan, and you have a politics disadvantage or an elections disadvantage. You might pick out of Congress, right? You might pick out of Congress and say we should have another part of the government do it, like an executive order, but it could be something else, right? You might also pick out of a certain part of the process. So we're talking about nuclear weapon, right? You could say, we should limit the use of nuclear weapons, right, by implementing a no first use policy for all of our nuclear weapons, except the ones that are on submarines. We're going to keep the ones that are on submarines, because those are the ones that are kind of placed around the world and maintain a certain kind of positional balance, right? And you might have a disadvantage that says if we remove our submarines and our nuclear-capable submarines from around the world, that would cause great chaos or great destruction in a variety of different places, right? Whether it's, you know, the Suez Canal, right, or very specific instances where the absence of U.S. military presence or the absence of U.S. nuclear presence might actually produce more chaos or more problems, right? So you could change the agent, or pick out of the agent, you could pick out of the object, right? Or you could pick out of the process, right? The way that it goes down. Okay. The other kind of pick that gets used a lot is a language pick, right? A language pick is when you think that the affirmative uses a language choice that is problematic, not relevant, or not helpful for the purposes of the debate. This is usually run with a critique of some sort rather than just a disadvantage. So you might say something like, so I was just reading this article, the policy topic this year is about climate change. Right, it's about climate change and greenhouse gas emissions and pollution. So I was just reading an article about how we shouldn't call it climate change. That makes it sound really nice. That instead we should call it climate chaos. Because that it's become a more chaotic weather and climate than it ever has been before. So you could run a critique on the word climate and say your use of the word climate normalizes this idea that change in the climate happens and that even extreme change can happen. And your pick would be, we're gonna run the affirmative because we think we need to do something in order to stop emissions, but we're not gonna call it climate change. We only wanna call it climate chaos. And then you would have some solvency evidence that proved why calling it climate chaos would be better, would actually solve the problem, right, in the harms of the affirmative still, right, and produces some sort of net benefit, right, whether on a linguistic or a material scale, right, for the negative. You can do this for any word, really, or any kind of phenomenon, right, that happens, as long as you have some evidence or you have some arguments that prove that your language choice or the language choice of the affirmative, right, is not preferential or yours is preferential, right? The most important thing to remember about picks, right, is just that you are picking out of a piece or a part of the affirmative and you are otherwise using the rest of it. Okay? So that is my introduction to counterplans. That's my introduction to counterplans. I know that was like a lot of information. We have 7 minutes. We have 7 minutes. So you can ask me questions about counterplans. You can ask me questions about topicality. You can ask me questions about whatever you want, right? But we only have 7 minutes, and I'm going to spur you along to go get lunch for the demo today. Yeah?
I don't know what a process counterplan is.
What's a process counterplan? Who remembers what a process counterplan is? Yeah?
It's where you do the same thing as the plan, except for you use a different agent, or not agent, but you do it a different way.
And what's an example of a different process?
Wasn't it having the president, going through the president in an executive order instead of having Congress have a law?
Good, right? They're both using the same agent, the U.S. federal government, but they're going through a different process within that agent, right, in order to do it. Good. Yeah.
Would that be like changing the enforcement?
Yes, when you change the agent, you're changing the organization or the individual that does the enforcement and the implementation usually, but not always. So like, for example, when you do an agent counterplan, this is a good example, right? Or not an agent, you do a process counterplan, it may not change the level of enforcement. So it doesn't matter if Congress passes it or if there's an executive order. It's the federal government, which means it trickles down and you have the same level of enforcement, right? But if you have a completely different agent, so like a private sector business, that enforcement may look different than if the government were to implement it. Does that make sense? So it depends on which part you're changing your counterplan.
And also, what part, like when it comes down to like the plan text and the enforcer and the agent, and what part do you change for a process counterplan?
You change the mechanism with which it would happen. So, yeah, so you can identify if you want the specific implementation and enforcement change if you like,
okay.
But it really depends on what part of the process you're changing,
okay.
Right? So another one I'll add to this is like having the Supreme Court do something, right? So campaign finance reform is a good example here, right? Citizens United is a Supreme Court decision that happened that radically altered the landscape of how campaign finance operates and who can donate and how much and what kind of disclosure is required. So there's been lots of talk about Congress passing some bill in order to combat or kind of close the gap around what Citizens United created. So that's one, right, agent that could do it, right? Other people have said, no, we should have the Supreme Court take another test case and overturn the original decision of Citizens United. Okay? Those are two different tracks of solving the same problem. Different processes, but in the same house of the U.S. federal government. Okay? So those both have advantages and disadvantages in terms of time frame, implementation, enforcement, precedent, right, things like that, right? And it really just kind of depends on what the object of the resolution is, you know? That's why I keep bringing up different things like nuclear weapons or campaign finance reform, because I find that often that ends up determining some of these questions about what counterplan is more relevant or more helpful in any given debate.
Is it possible to combine two different strategies, like use time frame and agent combined?
You can have an agent counterplan that has a time frame net benefit.
Okay.
But you could, so that's one answer. But also, sometimes you can say, yeah, we want a different agent to do it, and we want them to do it a year from now. Okay? You can do that. I would warn against doing that. For the same reason that I warn against affirmatives having too many steps or too many components of their affirmative. Remember, every time you make an additional argument, you are opening up the size of your argument, making it more likely that the negative team will be able to get a link to something. Good affirmatives are small. They are within the resolution. They are small, tight little packages of argumentation and offense. Because when they're small and tight, right, you can sort of defend that argument against a lot of other things. The bigger that affirmative gets, sure, you might have more impacts. You also have more opportunities to lose the debate. The same thing is true for counterplans. The more steps or mandates in your counterplan, the more opportunities you're giving the affirmative to poke holes in or generate offense or arguments against your counterplan. So sure, maybe you want to do an agent counterplan and a time frame counterplan. I would want to make sure that it was super specific to the topic and that you would be able to win that presentation argument and that there wasn't any kind of big floating offense that you would be susceptible to that wouldn't also be relevant to the affirmative as you should perform. That's a good question.
Sure. I can't help but to find the consultation counterplan redundant. But can you offer a defense against the following example? I'll borrow yours. Let's say the plan is to strengthen the relations with Palestine, diplomatic relations. And the counterplan offered is let's ask the Israelis first. So if we ask them and they approve, it's the same, the outcome is the same as not having asked them, but they wouldn't mind because
what's the disadvantage to not consulting? Yeah.
Well, if you don't ask the Israelis and then they get upset, then they're questioning the ties that you have and their trust within the United States, and they are second guessing, like, well, what are they doing with the Palestinians? Like, are they going against us now?
And what might be the impact of that argument? Why would that be bad?
Oh, I mean, they can start a war, they can, all these bad things.
Good, right? There's a ton of existing violence in the Gaza and between these two countries. And, you know, there could be external violence to that, meaning between the United States and other people. So the thing to remember about all of the counterplans is that there has to be a big operating piece of offense that exists independently of both of the counterplan. So, like, if we decided to start directly having a conversation with Palestine, Israel would be freaked out. That's just a fact, right? That there would be consequences to us doing that. The counterplan is just a way of trying to manage that emotion or manage that relationship to help minimize the effects, right? That, what is your name?
Maddie.
That Maddie is kind of describing, right? So that's my first response, right? That the disadvantage or the offense is always there. The second thing I'll say is that that's what affirmatives often say in response, right? One of the affirmative answers to the consultation counterplan is like, thanks for telling me the act is a good idea. You don't have a reason not to do the act. You just have a reason to talk to some other people too. Permutation, right? Do both. Because if it's not true consultation, you're just lying to Israel. Israel doesn't want just like a check-in. They don't just want like a memo brief of what happens. Right? Israel on the up and up, and two, that we're not supporting Palestine. And if our app, right, the app in this debate is supporting Palestine, and Israel's upset about it, and we go ahead and do it anyway, who's to say that that disadvantage doesn't already happen, right, or doesn't trigger the disadvantage? So, like, your brain is in the right place, you're just thinking like an affirmative person. Those are like 2AC or member of a government organization.